Book discussion with Mary Magdalene and Jesus. Through the Mists by Robert James Lees. This is chapter 14, recorded on the 20th of January 2013, Wilkesdale, Queensland, Australia.
Welcome everyone to a continuation of our discussion of the book Through the Mists, as channeled by Robert James Lees. And this week we're discussing chapter 14, which is called The Relationship of Sleep to Death. And there's a lot to discuss in this chapter, and I'm looking forward to it.
Will it be a two-week discussion or a one?
We'll see how we go. No worries. Think you and I can talk the leg off a chair, so we might get through it in one, but we'll see how we feel. We can always stop midway.
Sorry about the cough.
That's okay. All right, so if we remember where we're up to in the story, do you remember where we're up to in the story?
No, not at all.
So Fred is with Kushner and he's just had the two illustrations. Mm. They've gone across the mist and they've had the two illustrations, one of the young woman who's drawn back to Earth and the other in the home of Robert James Lees.
Yep.
And we had that beautiful...
Very different situations.
Yeah, and showing how spirits can relate to the earth in a positive way or in quite a painful way, I suppose.
Yeah.
So now Fred is actually given the opportunity to see what it's like, this mists experience. Rather than crossing back over it, he has the opportunity to almost come, have a vantage point so that he can see the mists.
So instead of going through it,
yes,
he goes over it,
yes,
basically.
Yeah, mm. Yeah. And at the beginning of the chapter, he gives a very lovely simile of what it's actually like.
Mm.
So he says, again, I could see the error of speaking of the two conditions as two worlds, since they hold the same relationship to each other as the sea bears to land. While the mists are but the spray and vapour which arises as the waves of one break upon the shores of the other.
Mm.
I thought that's a beautiful simile or metaphor for what it's like.
Discussing how close the spirit state and the awake states are, the physical and the spiritual states are. Most people on earth have no real, you know, the sleep state or the spirit state is so alien to their concept and thought that they don't realise that they're just backing onto each other and able to communicate with each other and share information, ideas constantly.
Yeah, mm. And that was my reflection on reading that. What if we really understood that the mists really only stand... We're butting up against each other, really, in terms of reality, and it's really that close, and there's just some vapour in between. And how...
And barely even that in a lot of cases.
Yeah.
Quite often there are people overcloaked by spirits, so there's no vapour at all between them.
Exactly. But how differently would we live our life if we sort of knew that truth, I suppose?
Yeah, we would not have as much fear of death, would we?
Yeah.
And that's really one of the points of this chapter, I feel.
Yeah. So as we move on, we're going to actually talk about the sleep, but still now he's considering the idea of death.
Mm.
Yeah. And then he has some interesting reflections about what it's like seeing people pass over in various states.
Mm.
He sort of says that some were reached in the gentle wash and flow after the force of its breaking was spent. So again, he's using this metaphor.
Mm.
But others, the wave broke on in all its strength and fury. Mm. And I thought there he's describing really how passing can be for people. And also, I suppose, if someone passes at the end of their life quite peacefully in their sleep, as opposed to someone in their 20s who has a sudden car accident, one can be quite dramatic and the other is sort of a person gradually, almost over a period of weeks, leaving, withdrawing from this world and entering into the other state.
Although I also feel that he's not referring to it from a physical perspective either. He's also referring to it about the spiritual condition of the individuals who pass.
Certainly.
And what actually happens to them after they've passed sometimes can be quite violent in comparison to what people imagine because of their condition. And yet other people have a very simple and easy passing, very similar to Fred's himself.
Even though his was in quite a dramatic accident.
Even though he had a dramatic accident, his passing was very simple. It was like all of a sudden it was just like a swoon or whatever he called it. And, you know, now he's in a different state, not really seeing where he is and not understanding how he got there.
Yeah.
And it almost felt imaginary, but there was no pain associated with it, no emotional torment associated with it. And I feel that his reflection here is more about the emotional torment associated with many people's passing.
Yeah, I agree. And over the page, I found this very moving kind of description that he gives about there's a copious baptism that falls upon each person, and this idea about how the true man comes forth. And I found that to be at once very beautiful and very, it's striking what happens when we pass through the mist, because there's no hiding any longer.
No, and for many people it's very frightening, not beautiful.
Exactly,
For most people, they've spent their entire life on earth trying to cover up who they are. They've spent their entire existence on earth trying to be people that other people wanted them to be.
Yeah.
And so when they pass over into the spirit world, and then all of a sudden have to come face to face with who they truly are, it is a frightening experience for many, because they've spent all of their life avoiding who they truly are.
Yeah, and he says here, he describes the men who had lavished wealth upon themselves and made great professions that they might win esteem.
Mm.
And he talks about this whole life that people have built around getting esteem, admiration, building up the worldly things, I suppose, is what I felt.
Mm.
But the mist dissolved that hope, and the trembling ego came forth naked, barren and pauper-like.
Mm.
Yeah. For only deeds of pure, unselfish love can be carried through that ordeal which all have to pass.
And I feel this is one of the things too that comes as a shock to many people, is that they take actions which they believe and have been taught to be love, but because it wasn't pure unselfish love, but rather addictions of some kind, and many of them are hugely surprised after they've passed about those exact same acts. The acts they thought were loving and they thought would be rewarding actually turn out to be acts that actually have destroyed their soul, and have caused their condition of their soul to even degrade further than what they imagined.
Yeah. Yeah, and this idea of the men he describes who build their careers around getting esteem and having a big worldly kind of a puffed up life, it made me reflect a lot on who do I gain approval from? Who am I seeking approval from?
Mm.
Because I wrote a note in my margin, when we seek to gain approval from a world or persons in error, we immediately distance ourselves from God and damage our soul.
Mm.
Because unless I'm seeking to gain or better myself in the things that are godly, I suppose.
Well, I'd call them the things that God's universe values.
Yes, yeah.
So everything that God's universe values surround truth and love. You know, and the qualities associated with
those things. True love, isn't it, that you're talking about? Mm. Yeah.
And then everything that God's universe destroys are all to do with characters that are, you know, out of harmony with that. So when I say destroys, what I mean is that it's like there's a good illustration in the Bible where it talks about the time often of passing. Often people in Christians view it as a time of persecution, but the time of passing is like a fire put to the soul.
Mm.
What comes up, if it's gold, the gold will remain, but all the dross and other impurities in the gold all come to the surface, all are exposed, and eventually have to be dealt with. And And, you know, this is what most people don't realize, is that God's universe is constantly trying to expose within us all of the impurities. And when we pass, it is a great opportunity for us to actually see many of these impurities that we might not have seen earlier.
Yeah, and I suppose the striking thing that I thought of as he talks so emotively about the true man comes forth is the true man can come forth now, and passing doesn't even have to be an ordeal, because we know ourselves, we are ourselves. And
also, as we find out in this chapter, we go to sleep every night and can see ourselves more accurately in that state if we choose to.
Absolutely. All right, something I thought of for people perhaps watching as well is to consider when we, to look around in our lives, like this statement that I made of who am I gaining approval from?
Yep.
Look around in my day-to-day life, and who is it that I'm actually seeking the company of and seeking the good esteem of? Mm-hmm. Because if I can see in them things that are angry, wishing to hurt others, then immediately, even by me trying to gain their approval, there's a part of me that's trying to gain rapport with a person. And I'm not saying that we should dismiss people who have any kind of negative emotion within them.
No.
But if we are seeking the approval of someone at the expense of our higher aspirations...
And many people do this, yes.
Yeah, I mean...
Like how many people, I wonder, in the world today are seeking the approval of people who have this... new sort of thought that it's best to not believe in anything, and you're cool if you don't believe in anything, and you're cool if you sort of think it, you know, you've got an open mind, but you're not going to actually make a choice about anything. And if you're seeking the approval of those kind of people, you're seeking the approval of people in the end who basically have no direction in life and no desire to know truth.
Yeah.
And things like that. So.
Yeah, so immediately you, yeah. Mm. Yeah, it's a reflection that I had as I was reading.
Mm.
Yes. Anyway, and now this new thing happens, and Fred sees, hang on, there's a different kind of traveller I'm observing in this crossing of the mist.
And this is what I like about the spirit world so much, is that you can be observing one thing and thinking that you're observing one thing and checking it all out and examining, and then you notice something else happening just over there that you never considered was happening, and it's different to what you were observing, and now, but it's similar, and you start asking yourself questions, and this is how God teaches, I feel. God is constantly drawing us into an observation, and then during this observation we finish up being drawn into discovering something else that we didn't expect to discover.
Yeah.
And in this case it's this aspect of the sleep state in comparison to death that Fred is working his way through and discovering more truth about.
Yes, which, as we see, is going to lead him to quite a bit more revelation of truth about himself, and it's all this big journey he's on, led by his desire, that is just leading him through all these revelations, really, isn't it? So Krishna says to him, well, those are sleepers visiting their friends.
Shall I read the paragraph before, just so that...
Yes.
It says, while I was engaged in making these observations, my attention was several times attracted to persons who were passing either way, not through but over the mists, as we ourselves had done. Of itself, there was nothing in this to excite my curiosity, since their errand might have arisen from a similar cause to our own, or had been occasioned by a multitude of other reasons. But at least half of these travellers were attired in such peculiar robes as to make it very doubtful to me as to which estate of life they belonged. For some time I tried to solve the problem myself as to who they were, but all my explanations were unsatisfactory, so at length I referred the question to my companion.
And this is when he receives the reply that they're sleepers.
Mm.
But even, I love that also about the spirit world, that you can learn by looking, and even their garb and everything that, because there is no, there's much less opportunity for facade, then everything you observe has various ways of teaching you.
And of course this teaching is available to every single person who's currently alive on the earth, just through the experience of their sleep state.
Yes, and I'd love to discuss that with you further as we go on through the chapter because there's some good things to discuss about that. And of course, Fred is just totally surprised that this could be happening. And Krishna references the Bible here again and says that Paul was more right when he said, "Eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man to conceive the things which God hath prepared for them that love him."
Mm.
So that's from 1 Corinthians 2:9.
Mm.
But this idea that this is another gift that we have of being God's children, that there's something wonderful in store in this experience of the sleep state. Yeah.
And a reminder that we're always being educated even when we think we're not.
Yes. Mm. Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the boundless provision made for our happiness.
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm.
Okay. So.
And so he's incredulous, isn't he? He's
yes. going,
"What? What? How can this be? Let me clearly understand you, Krishna. Do you mean that before a person dies, when the body is taking its customary sleep between night and morning, the soul has the power to come away and rejoin and hold communion with all the friends who are dead?"
Yeah.
Is that what you mean?
Yeah. Yeah. And Krishna's saying, "Yep, that's what I mean." So, so there's obviously a lot for Fred to learn. And Krishna says, "But you would have known all this if you had have just gone home before you started off on this quest." And that brings Fred to a whole other set of questions. Home, what is this all about?
Mm.
And it also brings up in him a feeling, I think. He says, "It seemed laden, the word itself, home, seemed laden with music, peace and fulfillment of every desire that had ever disturbed me."
Mm.
Because we know from Fred's story already that he's had quite a lonely life on earth.
Mm.
And he's never really felt at home. So this concept of home.
He's never felt like he's had a very close friend or.
Yeah. Okay, so we're about to learn more about it. But one of the things that I had as a point for discussion here was when we talked about this idea that the provision for his happiness and what God has given for us, just how little we actually recognize the provision in every state that we have that God has put provision for us to learn and grow in every experience that we have. So not just in our wakefulness, in our relationships, in nature, because that's what we've seen already all through the book, all these different provisions, and this is yet another one. Okay. So this next part, as Krishna begins to educate Fred about the purpose of the sleep state and what's actually happening, he says that, well, first he says, if you had have gone home, then the whole experiences of your sleep life would have been restored to you. So that's telling us something immediately, isn't it? That when we pass through the mists and go to the place where we're home, where our home at that point, then we gain a lot of knowledge.
I don't think that happens particularly for everyone, but in Fred's case, certainly, that would have happened because he would have met the people who he spent time with in the sleep state all of the time.
Yeah.
And as a result of that, would have triggered memories that he was not actually aware of up until this point.
Yeah.
And this is an interesting thing about memories as well, I feel. A lot of people ask us about memories of our life and memories of first century and memories of the spirit world. But memories require a point of access.
Mm-hmm.
And this is something that most people on earth don't even understand about their own memories. The reason why we lose our own memories even is because we lose the points of access into them. And this is one of the reasons why we don't have a memory of our sleeping state, is because we lose, every time we wake up, we lose the point of access into them. And because the two lives are often quite different, and we're often know people in the sleep state that we don't know in the awake state, and we often, you know, spend time with people in the sleep state that we've never spent time with in the awake state, Because the two lives are so separate from each other, our mind often can't psychologically cope with the separation, with the fact that these two lives happen in an instant, every single day and night, you know, every time we go to sleep and every time we wake up, these instant changes are occurring. And because of that, we often switch off the recollection and therefore switch off the point of access into all of the memories.
This was something that I had noted, that we can choose to remember us. We don't have to wait till we cross the mist to have it all restored to us.
Mm.
We can choose it beforehand, but it's this point of sympathy or access that we have to develop, isn't it?
Yeah.
And
that's why I like what he says there, that, you know, Fred asked, what's the difference then between sleep and death? And Christian says, well, very little. There is very little difference, with the exception that the person who comes to sleep has to go back every morning.
Yes.
Basically, that's the main difference.
Yeah.
There's very little difference aside from that.
Yeah, exactly. And imagine if we had remembered our sleep state, and when passing across the mist wouldn't be a shocking at all, because it would be...
Yeah, I don't know if that's always the case either, because the darkness of a person's condition will determine how shocking their sleep state experience is.
Mm-hmm.
And so for many people on earth, they can't remember their sleep state situation because they have so much judgment about what they're actually doing in their sleep state. And because of the darkness of their own condition that they're unaware of in their awake state, they are actually engaging in things in their sleep state that potentially they might not be engaging in their awake state. And so this causes people a lot of disconcert, you know, it's very disconcerting to become aware of that, and therefore also there's a stronger desire to deny, and therefore a stronger desire to not know.
Yes, I suppose what I was proposing, because I've had that very experience, is that if we develop that desire to know now,
mm-hmm.
we have the shock, it's terrible, horrible, mm-hmm. we deal with it, and there's no longer any shock involved.
Exactly.
So that's what I mean. In fact, I would recommend it to everyone, developing this desire,
mm-hmm.
because in my experience, it's the things that I'm most afraid of, that I'm not willing to deal with in my awake state, that I pretty much end up attracting in my sleep state.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm personally aware that my sleep state experience has changed quite a lot,
mm-hmm.
but there's still, because I'm still avoiding quite a bit of fear in my awake state, I'm still receiving threats and things in my sleep state. And
from people who are angry and bitter and sometimes violent.
Yeah, and people who I don't, even at different times, people who I have said, I'm not actually going to have you in my life anymore because of the way you're treating me.
Mm.
Because I was still emotionally open to them in the sleep state.
You're still attracting
them. I would still be attracted. They could come and see me and tell me exactly what they thought of me.
Just tell you the things they couldn't tell you in their awake state.
Because
anymore.
I'm preventing them in the awake state. Yeah. So
very true.
I feel it's something that's a very powerful thing to develop. And also, I feel that because we've had this discussion at a seminar about the sleep state, and I did expose some things that I was very ashamed about, that I
realised.
And we've
had a lot of private discussions about the sleep state and what's happening in the sleep state.
Definitely. Mm. But I feel a lot of people also then go, oh, it's all bad. And it's actually not all bad either.
But often it is all bad for people, but right. It doesn't have to be, is probably the better way of saying it. You know, unfortunately for many people, their sleep state is often all bad because of their condition and what they attract and their fears and their rages and anger that they deny in their awake state. But it doesn't have to be all bad. There's lots of very good people and beautiful people who we can engage the assistance and help of in our sleep states. If we truly set our heart to it and our mind to it, we can engage their assistance during our sleep as well. And so therefore not always have these very negative and damaging associations with people who are trying to attempting to harm us in a sleep state.
Yeah.
By the way, for many people on the planet who go to sleep, they are attempting to harm other people on the sleep state as well. And coming face to face with that is a difficult process too. The fact that while you think you might be a nice person, sometimes when you go to sleep, you're often the Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde character, nature of your soul sometimes comes out, and you're often very bad people to other people. And,
yeah.
And there are cases with people trying to overcloak other people's lives while they're in their sleep state, trying to harm people that they hate,
yeah.
trying to kill people they hate, trying to have other people kill people they hate. You know, there's a long list of things that people try to achieve in their sleep state that is very dark and very damaging.
And I suppose the way I feel about it is that my true will or desire, it comes forth in the sleep state.
Mm.
There is much less facade. And so I often feel like as I develop my will to actually grow and to actually know God and to actually face my addictions, my awake state sometimes feels a lot more, oh my gosh, this is pretty intense, and you know, there's a bit of like turmoil happening in my life now.
Mm-hmm.
It's not as easy and comfortable.
Mm-hmm. Which is a good sign of growth.
Yeah, yep. It is, isn't it? Yep. It's a good sign that I'm shaking things up. There's yep. change occurring.
Yep.
And often at those times, because I'm more embracing my will in a positive direction, then my sleep state is, there's more positive experiences happening there.
Yes.
It's when I'm actually, for me, suppressing the knowledge of some of my darker desires that life can maybe flow along,
mm-hmm.
Or if I speak in the past tense, it did sort of flow along, and with not that much drama.
Mm.
But my sleep state, I was really living in a lot of these desire, the anger and the rebellion at what was occurring in this facade-like life, So I often think about that for myself.
Mm.
It's really what my true desire is in both states, that it's just that in my sleep state it can become more apparent.
And usually the only thing that stops a person from doing the things that they do in their sleep state when they are awake is the fear of judgment and condemnation from their peers.
Yeah.
Or society. Or society or anybody in general.
Punishment, yeah.
So, you know, if that is the only thing stopping us, there's a high likelihood that we'll be doing a lot of things in our sleep state that we won't be very proud to see once we pass, and that we have the ability to see every night if we chose to be honest.
Yeah, if we choose to actually develop that memory.
Mm.
Yeah,
mm.
Yeah, yeah. Mm. Okay, great. So,
can I just explain something to you about the book, about just the physical nature of the attachment? And this is something that Kushner mentions about the fact that the sleeper leaves their body in the physical state, but there is a cord, this silver cord, that remains attached to the physical body from the soul.
Mm-hmm.
And as a result, there's this cord that draws the person back. Now, for people who are now spirits who do not have a physical body anymore, there is no cord any longer. And the reason why there's no cord any longer is because there's no body any longer that they remain connected to that's alive.
Yes.
But it's the actual soul that provides the life to the body. And while the soul continues to provide the life to the body, this cord will remain intact. And therefore, any spirit in the spirit world is able to see who are the sleepers, the ones who are going to sleep every night, and who are the ones who are actually no longer living on earth who have died.
Yeah, great. Well, while we're on the physical aspects of it, Kushner then tries to explain to Fred about why the spirit doesn't need to sleep. He talks about the physical body actually needing rest, but the spirit doesn't need rest. And he talks a bit about...
Which doesn't mean, of course, that there are not spirits that don't sleep.
Well, this gets very interesting, doesn't it? So can you explain that to us then?
Well, a lot of people, after they pass into the spirit world and have left their physical body, have a state of emotional exhaustion of some kind. And the only way for them to recover from these kind of emotional exhaustions and physical exhaustions that have exerted themselves upon the spirit body is for them to rest and sleep. And during that time, sleep is a state of unconsciousness where they're not conscious of what they're experiencing. They still might dream, as we might do in our awake state, but you know, when we're on earth, when we're connected to our wake or sleep states, but we basically are processing through the emotional exhaustion. Mm-hmm. Once we get to a point where there's no longer a need to process through emotional exhaustion, it's all been released from the physical body that is spiritual in mm-hmm. its nature, then of course the person can become awake in the spirit world, and that's when they first usually realize that they're in the spirit world, for many of them. There are sometimes also after that they may need to sleep again. There are certain emotions that come up that cause them to recollect certain events on earth that they feel quite exhausted about and have a lot of emotions about, and once they process their way through those particular emotions, they might go to sleep for a short period of time to recover mm-hmm. from those particular experiences. But once all of those experiences are gone, then there's no need for the body in the spiritual body to sleep.
Yeah, and we did see earlier in the book, there's a chapter where Fred actually says goodbye to sleep. Mm. You know, he has his last sleep.
That's right.
Yeah, so yeah. And we had some discussion there. And it was quite an emotional topic for some people, this idea of a lot of people don't feel rested when they sleep.
No, and you can understand why when you understand the power of emotion.
Yes.
Because our emotions affect us in both our states.
Yes.
So, you know, if we've got terror in our body and terror in our soul, then no matter whether we're asleep at night or awake during the day, we're still going to have the terror present.
Yeah.
And even if we try to sleep to rest from the terror will be with us in our sleep state.
Yeah.
So we'll wake up in the morning feeling like we haven't slept, like we have no
rest.
Satisfaction
yes. yeah.
from the rest.
Yeah.
Mm.
And there was something else I wanted to talk to you about in this chapter, which was about insomnia and people who find it difficult to sleep. Now, obviously, there's some issues that they're avoiding. One of two things, I feel, avoiding in their sleep state. So the sleep state to them is a place of dread, and so they don't wish to enter it.
Yeah, there's a lot that can be said about it, actually, because
yeah.
it depends on when they sleep.
Mm-hmm.
See, some people are perfectly happy to sleep during the day, but they refuse to sleep at night. And these kind of people generally are refusing to sleep at night because other people from the earth who they don't like and but who they associate with at night but they're afraid of sleep at night.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't want to spend time with those particular
mm-hmm.
people.
Mm-hmm.
So what they do is they change their lifestyle and instead sleep during the day, and then they wake up when everybody else is going to sleep. And that way they get to avoid those people who they would normally attract in their sleep state.
In their sleep state. And also I feel, well, the second thing I was going to mention was if we've had some trauma around sleep as a child where we've actually been away from our body and something's happened to our body, or we've been vigilant during the night because of some other situation happening in our home, then often it's actually something related to our earth life that we're still carrying a fear around that then makes us hesitant to enter the sleep state, or only willing to enter it at a time when we feel our physical surroundings are safer.
Safe.
Yeah.
Yeah. So insomnia could be caused by the fact that we feel our spiritual surroundings are not safe,
mm-hmm.
or that we feel our physical surroundings are not safe at certain times, and as a result of that, we try to not sleep. There is also fears and how fears impact upon our sleep state life.
Mm.
Often most people on the earth have a large degree of fears that they're not aware of.
Yeah.
And as a result of that, they've got a large amount of things that trouble them. And this particular trouble often causes them to find sleep very difficult,
mm-hmm.
Or helps them to avoid sleep at certain times. Also, there are desires that are in the mix as well. You know, sometimes we have relationships with people who are only sleeping at certain times.
Mm-hmm.
We've met people around the earth who only sleep between, you know, 4 a.m. in the morning and, you know, 9
yeah.
a.m. And the reason why is they are conscious of the fact that they have a love lover,
yes.
a sleep state lover that they visit at those times, and that's why they go to sleep at those particular times.
Yeah.
And so there's all sorts of events yeah. that may dictate when a person goes to sleep and when they'll be awake.
I had a friend, a family friend she was actually, who I love very much, and she her son died quite young. He had cancer and he died. He was younger than me, and this was some years ago now. And after his death, she found it incredibly difficult to sleep. She couldn't sleep, really.
Mm.
And eventually she ended up developing the same cancer that he had, and she passed not so long ago.
Right.
But I always felt this really deep compassion for her, and I suppose sadness, because I felt she was grieving so much for her son that she... And yet she wouldn't let herself enter the state where she would actually see
Meet him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I often wondered if it was because she was resisting the full impact of her grief.
Of the grief.
And then eventually she ended up developing the cancer, which was lung cancer, so very much around
her
heart and her grief. And so I often think of Cher and just how we, even our emotional resistances, can prevent something that is now coming in this chapter, where a mother can actually see their child.
But and she's not going to want to see her child if she's got all this grief that she's unwilling to experience.
So that's
the problem, is that if we have a heap of emotions we're unwilling to experience, we're not going to choose something that triggers those particular emotions.
Yeah, that's what I felt for her it was all about. Yeah,
it's sad, eh?
Yeah, sad.
When the exact, that's the exact same thing that would have reassured her that everything's better now.
And he wasn't gone in the way that
he wasn't gone out of her life.
He was.
Although, also one of the things that has a tendency to prevent people from truly engaging their sleep when they have loved ones who have passed, is that sometimes the loved ones who have passed have passed in poor condition. And when they actually go to sleep, they get to see the poor condition of their loved one.
Mm-hmm.
And that really distresses them. And it distresses them far more than if they got no sleep. So many people avoid sleep so they can avoid the truth.
Yes, yeah.
There are many people who avoid sleep because they are trying to avoid the truth of their relationship. In their sleep state, they know their partner is cheating on them, but in their awake state, they want to remain completely oblivious to that.
Mm-hmm.
And so what they do is they stay away from their sleep, stay away from the potential of observing what their partner may be doing while they're asleep.
Yeah.
And so forth. There are so many reasons why a person may have difficulties sleeping or staying awake at different times and sleeping at different times.
All right, let's get back to the chapter. It's good to talk about these things, though, because I feel there's a lot of questions that come up in people when they read this chapter around the sleep state.
And I feel there's a lot of it's almost like a lot of people believe that there's very fixed rules about the sleep state, the awake state, what you can know, what you can't know, and all those kind of things. And that's not true at all.
Yeah.
There is so much that you can know, but a lot of it depends upon your willingness or your desire to know. And this is where I feel most people have very, very strong desires to not know truth. And one of the primary reasons why that's the case is they're afraid of knowing the truth. And that causes so much trouble in the short and long terms in our life. And it includes causing trouble with our sleep. Ironically.
There's a lot to be said for humility, isn't there?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
All right, just a question.
The person is very humble, by the way, always sleeps very well.
It's not a clear conscience, it's just humility, you reckon?
Yeah, definitely. Because a person who's humble feels everything that they need to feel during their awake state. There's no unfelt emotions left to feel. Any emotions that come up in their sleep state, they choose to feel while they're in the sleep state. So there's not any unresolved problems or tensions. And so they sleep very well, usually.
And we had that example when we talked about the sleep, and I think it was chapter 5 or 4 or something, where Elvira had written and said, I sleep so terribly, and I have so much sadness about sleep, but this one day I had a really big cry and I connected to this pain from my past and I slept so well. Why did that happen?
Mm.
And I said that very thing, that she'd actually just connected with herself and she could rest. Yeah.
Exactly. And the only other people I know who sleep really, really well are people in total denial.
So all of us lot who are really struggling in the middle is because we've shaken things up.
You're shaking things up, but you're not in total denial.
Yeah.
But you're not yet in a place of complete humility where you're actually embracing every emotion as it comes up.
Yeah. I can attest to that because I used to sleep very well and I have my ups and downs now.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And you go through that period where you have your up and down, and then after a while you start settling down again.
Yeah, you sleep well.
You sleep better. Yeah.
You sleep very well.
Well, no, it depends. See, for myself, it depends very much upon the feelings that aren't resolved. At the moment, I'm going through fears about acceptance of as different things, you know, that I need to accept between myself and God, and I feel quite afraid of them. And as a result of that, I'm not sleeping as well as I could be sleeping, which is pretty unusual for me, because normally I just close my eyes and then wake up in the morning and there's nothing in between, pretty much, in terms of my sleeping.
Yeah.
And yet, you know, that's not always the case, because it depends on what you're processing through or not processing through emotionally.
All right. Okay. Just something I thought people might have a question with here at the bottom of my page, where he talks about...
Which page is that?
161.
But they're not all the same.
But they're not all the same, we've just realised. So Krishna's talking about man being created in the image of God, which of course is in a spiritual rather than physical sense, for God is spirit. This offshoot of emanation from or begotten of God, which becomes man, then partakes of the characteristics of its source or origin. So that's part of his explanation as to why we never sleep, because God is always in this process of...
Can we describe it better?
I'd like more
clarity.
Yes. Yeah.
What he's really saying is that God is constantly awake. And everything that God chooses to do is fluid action.
Yes.
In other words, it's happening all the time. God's always making choices, no matter what's going on. There's this constant flow of choices and action with God. There is no pause in God's life.
Yes.
You know, God's always choosing
creation,
to act upon
decisions,
desire, create creation and so forth. And what God has done is created us to be very similar. But God nurses us into this condition. And by what I mean by that is that God has created the potential of that condition. But most of us, because of different things that are factors that are occurring within our soul in terms of what we've chosen to do in the past and so forth, and also what's been perpetrated against us in many cases from our childhood and our past, you know, and even before we were born, right from the time of conception, we lose this sense of fluidity of our life, of our of time and fluidity of existence. As a result of that, we become unconscious of the fact that sleep and awake state is all one continuous state. And we even say to ourselves, oh, I'm going to sleep now, I'll see you in the morning, like as if that ever happens.
Yeah.
Because the reality is you go to sleep now and the person you were just talking to, most likely, if they're going to sleep as well, will not be seeing you in the morning. If it was an interesting conversation, they'll be seeing you straight away. But we see the sleep as a pause to our existence. And if you think about it, we see death as a longer pause. And in fact,
a full stop to
our existence. And these are all false ways of seeing the truth. You know, there are truths and none of these things are true. Sleep is just a continuous part of our life. It's not a pause to our existence, and death is not a pause to our existence either. And this is what he's saying here, is that God's created us with this inherent potential to be like God in this way, in that everything is just a fluid existence without a pause.
Which is pretty cool, hey?
Yeah.
And that there's no night in heaven.
No.
Yeah.
No.
And that the spiritual part of man never wearies.
Yeah, and that's not strictly, you can't take that as a strict truth, because there are times when the spiritual part of man is weary and does need to rest, but it never wearies in the sense that there's never this break in time where you're not conscious of something occurring.
And it's not like the physical body, which actually does sort of...
break in time in its consciousness.
Deplete, and yes.
So whenever we go to sleep and we move out of our physical body, from that moment on, the brain itself is not really recording all the events. The physical body's brain is not the filter of all the events anymore. It's the spirit body's mind that is the filter of all the events. So the physical body's brain is only there for physiological functions in that point, and therefore doesn't need to remember anything. And it's the spirit body's mind that is remembering everything from that moment on. So the spirit body's mind remembers lifting up out of the body. It remembers going to a certain location in its sleep states, talking to different people, chatting with them, spending some time with them, having some fun with them, or maybe not fun with them, depending on what the situation is. And then remembers returning. You know, it remembers the feeling that the physical body is now going to wake up. And so it feels pulled back, drawn back to its physical body. And in fact, if it didn't go back, the physical body would die,
mm-hmm.
actually.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how people die in their sleep.
Yeah.
Because they refuse or mm-hmm. have not gone back to their physical body
yeah.
in the morning or when it has awoken. And it's the physiological functions that drive the physical body's need to wake up.
Yeah.
And that is what causes the spirit body to be drawn back
mm-hmm.
into the physical body. But if we understood all of that properly, and we really felt all of that properly, we would not only see it in terms of our belief system as one continuous state, but we'd remember it as one continuous experience.
Exactly. And this thing, Krishna talks about this idea of the physical brain and its spiritual equivalent, which mm. we call that its mind,
mm-hmm.
That there's a difficulty in their relating, and that prevents the translation of memory of mm-hmm. the higher into the lower condition.
Mm-hmm.
Because
if we can just remind everyone,
yeah.
it's not the physical body's brain that remembers anything. Now, we have proof of this medically, because when a person has a stroke, a part of their physical brain actually dies.
Yeah.
And yet, many times, a stroke victim can learn the parts and remember the parts that have died later.
Yeah.
Now, for them to have that occur, if the physical brain stored the memories, it would be impossible for that yeah. to ever happen.
Yeah.
And this is an indication that something else stores the memories.
Yes.
The spirit body's mind stores the memories, and the brain, once it's repaired of any damage, can go back to the place, and even new places can absorb those memories.
We call it the plasticity of the brain,
exactly.
which is that where pathways once existed, if they're damaged by a stroke or a head trauma,
mm-hmm.
then the basic medical belief is that a new path, the brain is plastic, so it can actually, you can find a new pathway to learn that thing. But what you're talking about is actually memory, which we do also see.
Well, you're finding a new pathway to remember that thing.
Well, it depends, doesn't it? If I'm relearning to pick up a cup, or if I remember to pick up how to pick up a cup, or if you're my husband
and I can't remember
you,
that you are.
Yeah, and that part of my brain doesn't recover, but then I remember you, then obviously
that information has come from somewhere else.
Mm. Yeah, and I find it fascinating because we do see the brain as this pinnacle of like creation and this one of the great mysteries of, you know,
our existence.
What does it do? How does it all work? It's amazing. And yet, really, Krishna is saying
it's
a device. Yeah, that the mind is. And imagine if we could tap the mind. And we were talking earlier.
And some people do tap the mind.
Yes.
Quite regularly. Like, this is why people who have different types of medical, what we call situations or illnesses or genetic disorders, sometimes they have a huge intellectual capacity. Some can make computations of very large, long numbers, for example, instantly.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's because they are, in that regard, using their mind without any resistance of the brain.
Yeah.
And so our brains, or it would be better to say the emotional condition that dictates what happens to our brain, determines how well we function in our spirit mind
mm-hmm.
and how much of that information actually gets to our physical brain and therefore to our awareness in our awake state.
Yeah, very fascinating, very fascinating. Yeah, okay, so we're jumping around a bit, but mm-hmm. Let's talk about...
You just take me where I'm meant
to go. Yeah, yeah. Well, let's talk. We've talked about the silver cord. We've talked about the weariness that we can have spiritually.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about... Krishna is talking about... Fred says, how can each sleeper make sure of finding the desired friend?
Mm-hmm.
And Krishna says that there's a provision made for that, just like there's a provision made for everything else.
Mm-hmm.
Just as there are localities adapted to every possible condition of the soul which has left the body, so there is a sleep state, a boundary or halfway condition where those meetings take place. Now, I find this very interesting. Krishna's basically saying, isn't he, that it doesn't mean that we actually enter the spirit world as such, but we enter specific locales. Do you agree with this? Is this the truth?
Well, no, he is saying that we enter the spirit world, I believe. But it's a place where everybody can meet.
So in other words, it's a
condition where the people of the highest possible conditions in the spirit world can go to if they wish to. But it's also a place where people in the lowest possible conditions can go to.
Yes.
And so it becomes a meeting place of pretty much any condition, which when you think about it, is pretty much what the earth is.
So
it's very, very similar to the earth in that regard. It's just happening in our sleep.
Yeah, I felt that's very interesting. We're obviously in the spirit world, but there's a provision there and there's a meeting place for us. It's not that we go off and enter necessarily our spirit life of what it will be exactly when we pass.
No, we can observe it if we wish, because we are able to go to those locations in the spirit world where our soul condition actually is.
What
our soul condition is will dictate where we can go in the spirit world.
Yeah.
And so we are able to actually visit the locations where we would live if we had passed.
Mm.
And in fact, many people do actually go to those locations where they would live if they had passed, in particular many children. For example, would go to places in the spirit world where they would actually live once they pass.
Mm.
Obviously, though, as we improve in our ability to sin, or if we improve, if we call it, we expand our ability to work and live in harmony, out of harmony with love, we are degrading our condition, and therefore, in many cases, where we would sleep or the locations we can visit when we sleep are not. Are of better condition than the locations of where we would go if we died. And and a lot of people would be very stressed to know that, of course. And so that's one reason why they don't know it. They don't, you know, one reason why they don't want to acknowledge it. So the reality is we can meet people from all conditions in this location, if you like. It's a location which is very similar to the location in its nature as to when we first pass, once we make that first transition, it's the same location we go to pretty much. And within a very short period of time, our soul draws us to the actual location that that our soul has created for ourselves to exist in.
Very interesting, huh? Okay.
And you said, well, let's go and visit one of these rendezvous places.
Yeah.
Do you want to go there? Yeah, sure, let's go. Fred says.
Okay. Where are you? I'm not
on the same page, just under where you read from.
He says here, I don't know where you
were. We will visit one of these rendezvous if you wish it. One of these halfway states is what...
And
Fred says, oh, I'll be delighted, but do all the sleepers come here?
Well, that's right.
There's nothing preventing them from coming there. But it depends on their choice,
of course.
That's the only thing that would ever prevent anything from occurring, aside from the condition of the soul.
But it's very likely, isn't it, given that we are drawn by our true will and desire in this state, that we wouldn't go somewhere to enact our will and desire when we're in our sleep state.
Yeah, or it'd probably be more direct to say that we would go somewhere that our desire dictates.
And that's why he says that the great majority of mankind do.
Exactly, exactly. There are very few people who don't, and this is why there are very few insomniacs. They are people who don't want to go there, obviously. For whatever reason.
All right. Okay. So then he talks about this idea of the physical brain and the mind.
Yes.
Prevent the translation of the memory.
Yep.
And my feeling, as I've said earlier, is that we can develop a sympathy between our mind and our brain. Even just by having this knowledge, we immediately make it, there's more of an ability to transfer that.
Yes, but I know the knowledge does improve it to a degree. However, if the emotion within us is that I don't want to know,
of course,
I am never going to know. So I might say to myself in my mind, I desperately want to know what's happening in my sleep state, while at the same time having a terrible amount of terror
of what?
About what is happening in my sleep state inside of my soul. And that terror will dictate my knowledge. Yeah. And so it would be impossible under those circumstances for my brain to become aware of, through the spirit body, in connection with the spirit body's mind, of the events that are actually occurring. And I feel that's the case for most people. That's why most people cannot remember, even though they say they'd like to.
Yes, yeah.
It has to be driven by a true emotional feeling that you desperately would like to know what is actually occurring, and that there an openness to actually examining it in truth. Mm-hmm. And that's where I feel most people struggle. And I struggle too in that regard. Like, I still myself struggle at times knowing everything that's happening, because every time I remember things of my spirit life at the moment, I have a big cry about the fact that my material life isn't the same.
Yeah.
And so, you know, for that reason, there is resistance about remembering what's going on in the sleep state, because what often is happening for myself in the sleep state is far more beautiful and powerful than what my life on earth is reflecting.
Yeah.
And as a result of those differences, whenever I remember, I've usually got a lot of grief to feel.
And I had that experience for the first time in reading this chapter anew just in the last week, of feeling, I felt sadness come up in me as I was considering this idea of remembering my sleep state, because often at times here on earth I feel like there's not a lot of friends around us. There's you and me, you know, in terms of a real heart connection with us as people.
And also who understand everything about our lives. It's very hard to understand the life of a person who's lived for 2,000 years if you haven't lived for 2,000 years.
Yeah.
And very hard to understand the emotions they would have.
Exactly.
So we understand that, but it is, there's also grief associated with that.
Yeah, and for the first time reading it, I felt my friends saying, hey, you know, we get to hang out in the sleep state, and this resistance I have of feeling the grief associated with. So it can even be that we're having great experiences that we don't want to remember that make us.
Because if we remembered them, we'd cry or feel quite overwhelmed with sadness, or overwhelmed with other emotions. You know, you could be overwhelmed with all sorts of emotions, not just sadness, that would you try to repress or try to not feel.
But Krishna says that the sleep state could then be pressed into service as the most important factor in the regeneration of the world. Now, that's a pretty big statement.
Mm-hmm.
It's saying that if we just remembered our sleep state, we could heal the whole world. Is that what he's saying?
Yeah, in a lot of ways we could, if you think about it. Because even just in one area, the majority of mankind's choices on earth are driven by the fear of death. The reason why we become greedy is all about the fear of death. The reason why we harm other people is all generally about the fear of death, the fear of not having enough, the fear that one day will pass and it will all be gone.
Mm-hmm.
The reason why we react violently in most cases is because we're afraid. The reason why we choose to destroy things around us rather than regenerate them is because we're afraid that, you know, again, of the same kind of things. If we all understood, every single person on the planet understood this one truth, that we have a seamless existence, a seamless life, there's no such thing as death, there's no such thing, even the sleep state is a real state, we can communicate with each other, sleep or awake, there would be no boundaries, no physical mm-hmm. boundaries that the earth places upon us in terms of have fun with other people, you know, talk with other people and so forth. If we consider just all of those factors, how much would our life change?
Yeah.
Like just that, even just that one factor of fear, all of a sudden all of our fears would be gone. We wouldn't be warring with each other anymore as a result of this one mm-hmm. truth that all of us believed.
Yeah.
If all of us felt the truth of it, we wouldn't be warring with each other anymore, because what's the point?
Yeah.
You can't kill anybody. They're all just going to be in the sleep state anyway.
And this bit of land that we're all so concerned about, gosh, what's when we go point? To sleep. And I suppose that's the crux of this chapter, the relationship of sleep to death, is that while we believe in death, you know, while we don't remember our sleep state,
we believe in death.
Yeah.
And while we believe in death, that causes huge amounts of very damaging actions here on the earth and also in the lower realms of the spirit world, because there are many people there that are still scared of death.
Yeah.
And these particular things would all dissipate quite a lot if we could remember our sleep state.
Yeah.
And, you know, this is the why he made that statement.
Yeah.
The reality is just that one fact of all of us seeing that we will never die would create huge change on this planet if we all believed it.
Yeah.
But only if we all believed it, not if we just thought it.
Yeah.
There's plenty of people around the world who, you know, there's 1.3 or 4 billion Christians who believe there is an afterlife, but it doesn't mean that they really believe it in their hearts, because if they did, they wouldn't be so worried about dying. They wouldn't go to war with anybody ever.
Yeah.
Because they wouldn't be worried about dying. Yeah. And the same applies to the Muslims, you know, like they have a very similar belief that there is an afterlife, but if they really believed it, they wouldn't be worried about dying. So therefore they wouldn't be worried about fighting anybody. They wouldn't, you know, they wouldn't try to conquer someone or get back at somebody. So you'd automatically have, just in those two religious groups, you'd automatically have 3 to 4 billion people all of a sudden not worried about death.
Yeah.
And therefore not worried about killing anybody and not worried about themselves dying or any member of their family dying or any other thing. And what kind of effect would that have on the earth? Just
absolutely.
A huge positive effect.
Huge.
Yeah.
So then Krishna starts to give the example of a mother whose child dies in infancy, mm-hmm. which is a sort of a micro demonstration of everything the effects of the belief in death and the forgetting of our sleep state.
And Cushion's a pretty clever man, right?
Yeah.
Because he chooses the exact reciprocal of Frederick's own life.
Yeah.
And this is a great way of teaching Fred and a number of different things later that he will learn as well.
Because Fred's, we learnt earlier in the book that Fred's mother died at his birth.
Mm.
So he's never known his mother, or so he thinks.
So he thinks.
Yes. Mm. So he talks about just the grief of the mother and the fact that actually when she goes to sleep she can begin to have this relationship with her child that she would have liked to have on earth.
Mm. And I feel the comments that he makes about the mother placing herself out of sympathy with the child, I feel that is the point that he's trying to arrive at, is that the mother could be constantly aware that my child is still alive. The child could have, many children are often surrounding their parents on earth, but the parent just can't see them.
Yeah.
But they're often with the parent as they're doing different day-to-day activities on earth when after they have passed. And the parents are totally unaware of this because they're unwilling to grieve the loss and unwilling to work through the different emotions that caused them to feel grief of the loss. And as a result of that, they're not conscious of the presence of their child. And they also don't visit their child in their sleep state, ironically, when both conditions, they could have 24-hour access to their child, and instead they have a feeling that there is no access to their child. The child is completely gone. They'll never see them again. And how many families do you see this happen with? When the child dies, the family becomes so distraught, it gets torn apart. You know, everyone's unhappy and bitter, and all of this unhappiness doesn't need to actually occur if people actually could understand the truth and actually feel it.
And Krishna says that it is only the sin of the mother placing her out of sympathy with the child.
Exactly.
But he talks about the idea that this is protective for the child.
Well, in some ways it is protective for the child, because if the mother entered the location of the child constantly dumping her own, in a selfish way, dumping her own grief upon the child every time she saw the child, then you could imagine this would greatly distress the child.
Mm-hmm.
The child's there going, "Mum, I'm still alive. Why in the hell are you crying?" And Mum's going, "But you're not alive. I don't get to see you, and I don't get to do this, and I don't get to do that with you, and I don't get to see you grow, and I don't..." And she's not working through all of her distresses. She's quite self-involved. And in that state, it is preferable that she doesn't meet her child.
Yeah.
Because if she met her child, she would dump all of these emotions on the child. She would make her child feel guilt. She would make her child feel bad about dying. She'd make her child feel earthbound, and then the child couldn't learn and live its own life in the spirit world and discover new things in the spirit world and move on with its life. And as a result, the child would be constantly drawn back to the mother, constantly inhibited by the mother's, you know, own lack of ability to deal with her own grief.
Yeah.
And I don't know if we could really call it grief, because it's not true grief. It's not a sincere grief.
Mm-hmm.
It's a selfish, narcissistic way of seeing her loss of her child. And as a result of that, it's far better that the child is prevented from meeting its mother under those circumstances.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's just another example, isn't it, of like, I think Krishna says in here somewhere that God is so much better than men imagine. That, you know, often people get so angry with God when a child dies, and yet God has a provision that relationship doesn't have to end.
Yeah. And I've talked to many children who have died from cancer, for example. They are happy as Larry. Like, I know that's the saying here. I don't know what the saying is overseas, but, you know, they are just so happy that they get to experience all these things. You know, some of them were telling me about the things that they're making and the whole, some of the houses that they've built and how interesting the whole thing is. And then I ask them about their mother. Oh, yeah, she's still grieving that I'm dying, and I don't spend much time with her because she's grieving still. And every time I go to her, she cries, and, you know, and the only unhappiness in their life oftentimes is the response of the people who are still alive on earth. And I've talked to many millions of these children over my lifetime, and they all basically feel the same thing. So you can see why God's provision is such that they don't have to return to their families while their families sort of exorcise their so-called grief, which is really other emotions in most cases, because in reality, if they knew the truth, most of them wouldn't even grieve and wouldn't need to grieve, because they'd be able to feel their child, they'd be able to feel the child's joy, they'd be able to feel the child enjoying its own experience, they'd be happy for the child's experiencing what it's experiencing, they wouldn't feel the loss of the child, they feel like they can communicate with them still, the child can hear them, they can hear the child.
Yeah.
And eventually, if they were really open, they'd be able to see their own child.
Yeah,
just like
in the awake state.
Just like Robert James Lees could see the spirits who came to him to talk with him.
Yeah. And even in here, Krishna just gives this full example of how the mother, even the mother longing to see the child, if a mother really allowed herself to grieve enough and just have that sincere longing, the
child,
she would see them in their sleep.
Yep.
And he contrasts all of, you know, this grieving, terrible 20 or 30 years before you actually see your child again when you pass,
mm-hmm.
with this idea of, just as you said, that you could have this complete relationship with them. And just, I love the analogy he gives, just as you're waking up, it's as if you're kissing their head, that they're going off to school.
Exactly.
And it's such a contrast. And if we think about that with anyone who's passed, that is the potential of our relationship with them.
Yeah.
As we said earlier, transformative for the whole world.
Exactly. And transformative not only in personal ways, but in ways that affect the peace of the entire world.
Yeah.
So it's not just a personal a viewpoint that needs to change here, but if everyone changed in their personal viewpoint, the immense effect it would have upon people's decisions and choices on
Absolutely.
Earth. It'd be so great that we wouldn't know Earth.
Yeah.
As you know, we wouldn't even know it in its, it would never be or could ever be in its current state.
Yeah. And I don't think people really have a clear conception of just how much the fear of death and the fear of pain affect their day-to-day decisions. And perhaps that's a good homework question for people, really consider in your life how many decisions you make in a day that are related to your fear of death or fear of separation from your loved ones.
Yeah, so, you know, in our talks that we have with people, I often say to people, very few of you have dealt with your fear of death. And it's interesting, I don't normally say it like that. I normally say, who of you feels that you've dealt with your fear of death? And almost everybody in our audiences puts up their hand. And yet, what I see happening in their day-to-day life mm-hmm. is proof every moment that they have yet to confront their fear of death. Yeah. And therefore also yet to confront this whole concept that they can sleep and know exactly what everything's going to be like.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm. And for me, I feel like I would raise my hand, I'm not afraid of death, but I am afraid of separation from you.
But there is no separation,
exactly.
Is my answer.
If I had have dealt with the truth about death, wouldn't fear any separation.
Well, you think about when I passed in the first century, the only separation that actually occurred was your grief, wasn't it? And the rejection of your grief. And then also how disciples treated you after my death and how, that affected your own feelings about yourself.
Yeah.
From my perspective, there's no separation whatsoever.
Yeah.
But from your perspective, because of all of those things, they had a big impact. Later in your life in the first century, we spent more time together and we knew, we talked and conversed with each other and spent time together all sorts of times.
Yeah.
Every night when you went to sleep, of course, we spent all of that time together as well.
But so during the day, often we would be in conversation.
During the day as well. And so you became more conscious of the fact that there was this no separation between those two states. But often it's the grief, isn't it? Or the desire to not experience it.
That's the desire to not experience
the desire to not experience shame, the desire to not experience fear that causes us to not understand and also not accept.
Well, now that you're speaking of the first century, Kushner mm-hmm. now begins to speak about you in the first century.
Mm-hmm.
He says some lovely things. But
because the question is, why hasn't anybody taught this on the earth before, right?
Fred says, Kushner, you're going to wipe away even the remembrance of death if you keep going on. And he actually says, well, if Jesus tried to do it and failed, I don't know if I'm going to have much success.
Exactly. I'm going to try again, by the way.
We'll keep trying. But he says rightly that you never in any single instance voluntarily use the word death, really.
No.
That you never acknowledge that there was a death, really, or a change in the state.
Yeah, well, my concept of the definition of death as man sees it is this ending of life.
Yeah.
And to me, death as a word cannot really be appropriately used in my vocabulary
mm-hmm.
except to try to connect with people about their beliefs about it, because the reality is there is no such thing as death, none whatsoever.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a change of state where we lose a body, we lose our physical body, but in terms of who we are and everything that we can experience, it is enhanced upon dying generally. And so, in my opinion, it's very, very difficult to see the word death as having any negative connotations whatsoever. And I feel that's one of the reasons why many people in the first century sort of viewed me strangely, because the concept of death in the first century was very fixed.
Mm-hmm.
There was no clear understanding about what happened after you died. And as a result of having very little comprehension about what happens after you die, the majority of people had a huge amount of fear about death. And of course, death was quite a prevalent thing because of the different wars and a seeming lack of respect for life that existed in many cases as well. It was a very common occurrence and people were very frightened and would do anything possible to avoid it. And this is what I feel is one of the problems about death, is that people will do anything possible to avoid it when it's nothing to avoid.
Yes.
And in fact, if anything, it can open up a person to far more opportunities and experiences than they've ever had possible on earth. Now, I'm not encouraging people to die because that would be suicide.
Mm-hmm.
And I cannot agree with suicide because anybody who has suicided has all sorts of problems associated with their death. The biggest one being that they have murdered themselves and they are now going to, in their soul, be treated, and God's laws will treat them as a murderer in the process. So you know, I'm not encouraging people to die. I'm just saying there's nothing to be afraid of.
And also, just as I mentioned earlier, as we're shown in this chapter, that God, there's a provision in every state that we're in. And I feel that there's a if God's got us here in the nursery of our soul in a physical body, there's a big purpose involved in that.
Yeah, so there are many things we learn here that it's very hard to learn elsewhere.
Yep. Absolutely. Yeah. And we've touched on that as we've read through the myths until this point as well.
Yeah, and there's been many presentations I've given where I've talked about, you know, the things that we can learn here and some of the difficulties people face when they haven't learned those particular things here. In the discussion on abortion that we had with Barbara McNair, I talked often about, you know, the difficulties that aborted children face because they did not have the ability or the circumstances to learn particular things here that they could have learned, and as a result of that, find it very difficult to learn after they've passed.
Yeah.
And so, you know, God has created everything for a reason, and the nursery of the soul, which is this physical location in which we live, is definitely been created for a positive reason for our soul's development. But we need not fear losing it.
Yes.
That's the point.
That's the point.
And most people have a terrified of losing it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And hence, they're often very damaging actions towards others, very unloving actions towards others.
Yeah.
You know, you think of how many wars have been caused and perpetrated and also continued because of everyone being so afraid of what might happen to them if they allow another person to come and kill them.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, so really in the first half of this chapter, we've discussed a lot of the reasons why people find it difficult to remember their sleep state. Mm-hmm. They don't have this idea that it really even exists.
Mm-hmm.
Then they've got all these emotions that they're resisting that would allow their memory of it.
Yep.
Now Kushner is talking about some societal issues, religious issues that actually prevent people fostering this knowledge of the sleep state. And I think this is very interesting. Again, Kushner is always giving us lessons about the Christian faith as it existed on earth then.
Yes. And you can understand him doing so, bearing in mind that most of the Christian faith claims that they came from my teachings. And so therefore, you know, he's referring my teachings and comparing them with what the Christian state is today.
He's clarifying them all of the time. He's another of our friends who wants to bring divine truth to earth. So he says something really interesting, that that the church has the idea that the full day of creed has come, and that means that all of God's truth is here in the Bible. I don't have my Bible. You know, the prophets have brought it all, and you brought it all, and that's it. There it is. And this dismisses the idea that God might bring more truth.
It also dismisses the idea that Jesus grows.
That Jesus grows, that God is infinite. It dismisses a lot of truths, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's very damaging. Yeah. I think tomorrow we might even address some of those issues in the FAQs with regard to these religious thoughts that, you know, everything is fixed.
Yeah, that would be great. I'm looking forward to that. But he talks about the fact that children have to be checked and crushed as wicked, you know, these things, the superstitions and works of the devil when they have dreams.
Mm-hmm.
When
they have
sleep state experiences which bring truth to
And they have little friends
you know,
in their awake state.
Yeah, yeah.
That they can see and talk to and converse with.
And this terrible fear that the Christian religion has had historically of
spirits
and calling
them
the devil.
It's a shocking fear.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it began from the fear of the Jews, that the Jews had with spirits as well. Yeah. There was terrible fear amongst the Jewish society about spirits. And you can understand to a degree why that is the case, because many of them were completely overcloaked by evil or distressed spirits.
Yeah.
And as a result, you know, you would often see in the Jewish state, you know, in the first century where we live, you would often see people totally overcloaked in terrible condition, almost like living almost like animals. And everyone knew they were possessed and therefore very, very frightened of what a spirit might do if it grabbed hold of you and possessed you.
Yeah.
And as a result of, you know, and this fear came about from many centuries and millennia even earlier, when, you know, when the prohibitions of spirit communication even began, it was present then because of the actions that people would take once they became spirit possessed.
Yeah. And so we can see even in the church that someone somewhere said, look, there's this bad spirit
influence
happening.
We've and we know that it's there.
Stop this happening for people. And so they took on this role of
preventing it,
mm-hmm. making it a problem.
Mm-hmm. But in the process, suppressing through fear, which is not loving action. And this is what I see people constantly doing. They think they're doing something good, but they choose to do it in a manner that breaks God's laws, and in particular breaks the laws of free will and breaks the laws of love, breaks the laws of truth. They'll even prepare to lie about it, that, you know, so they're breaking the laws of truth. And as a result, the end result can never be good.
It's never going to
never
work
going
out
to work out for them.
No.
And
no.
And this is the problem of what happens with the Christian church.
Yeah.
The end results never can be good if you're going to suppress these truths through just in order to protect somebody from themselves.
Yeah.
You know.
And it's interesting because Krishna makes a point about the leadership in churches.
Yep.
And he says this compels the preacher to drop the role of prophet and assume the position of priest or lawyer.
Mm-hmm.
So this controller of, rather than a leader in truth and a leader in discovery, he's saying that churches are actually controlled by people who are litigious and trying to keep everyone in order.
Yeah, and I think if we explain more to the people who are listening what how the viewpoint of it is in the spirit world,
there is
sort of this viewpoint in the spirit world that is, that is amongst all of the people in the celestial heavens, and that is that there is a deep separation, a rift between the priest and the prophet.
Yes.
The priest's role is to control, to invoke law and control the people. The prophet's role is to inspire.
Yeah.
And it's the prophets who cause growth.
Mm-hmm.
And I, this is why any reference to myself as a priest,
or
I
a certainly rabbi.
Yeah. Or, yeah, reject,
yeah.
because I am not a priest. I am a prophet in the sense that I will continue to and will continue to inspire people about the truth through the transmission of information from the spirit world to the earth. But I'm never going to make sure that people follow it.
Yeah.
That's what a priest does, and that's not what I am ever going to do, and we will never do that because we understand that every time you do that, you're starting to attempt to control people's will. And when you control people's will, you are now breaking God's laws, and it can never work out well for you.
Yeah.
And I think it's important for people who are listeners and also people who are reading the book Through the Mists and the Life Elysian and the Gate of Heaven to understand the difference between the priest and the prophet. Every time in the Bible, for example, you read about the priest and what the priest has said, you can pretty much guarantee that you could dismiss most of the information.
Mm.
The reason why is that it's controlling, manipulative, often
fear-based,
fraught with lies or untruth,
sometimes
purposeful, sometimes not. And it's fear-based manipulation many times of the people. You can often listen to the prophet because there will often be a lot of inspiration with the prophet and a lot of direction that you can take a lot of. And this is what I did in the first century. This is how I discovered divine truth in the first century, was I started working out that, yes, it appeared to me, even the way I saw my own father, was that he was only interested in law, and that he was a legal person, a legal mind, a legal person. He was eventually a Pharisee,
mm-hmm.
and he was only interested in law. He was only interested in making sure the people followed the law, and it wasn't inspirational at all. And in fact, it was very controlling.
Mm-hmm.
And he would often get very angry, and he would often become quite violent, of course. And he'd even be sometimes violent with members of the family as a result of his beliefs. And then when I compared that with a person who would be a prophet, who would be a person who was inspirational, who would inspire other people by what they say, whether it came from spirits or from their own concept, I started seeing that the Bible is really, in a lot of ways, divided into these two classes of people who are sharing what they believe is truth.
Yeah.
You've got the prophets sharing all this stuff, and you've got the priests sharing all this stuff. And when I started connecting with the priests, I started feeling all of those same feelings that the majority of people felt when they were connected to the priests, and that is feelings of oppression, someone trying to take mastery over me, someone trying to control me and manipulate me into doing what they want and so forth. When I connected with the prophets, I felt inspired. I felt drawn towards God's love, drawn towards understanding more about God and more about truth. And then after a while, I started realizing even truths that what the prophets were alluding to without them even knowing. Mm-hmm. And that's when I discovered divine love and how to access divine love. And none of that would have occurred for me if I'd just listened to the priests.
Yeah.
And I feel that's one thing we need to bear in mind with this particular discussion, is that he's now starting to introduce this concept of priesthood versus prophets.
Yeah.
And later in the books, you'll see many comparisons of those particular two forms of classes of teachers, if you like.
And certainly, I mean, I get very emotional as you talk about it as well, because I know that's been very much our role as people who inspire, and any leader, I feel, any leader, not just a spiritual leader. The leaders who succeed are not the ones who are interested in controlling a group of people. No. They're the ones who are striking out themselves.
Yeah.
They're walking they're representing.
Exactly.
And they're discovering things.
Yeah.
And showing people the way literally by them walking away.
By their example.
Yeah.
You look at who's the most famous person you can recollect from India?
Gandhi.
And what do we know about Gandhi?
Yeah.
He was a person who inspired. He wasn't concerned about making laws. He was always confronting laws that were unloving. He was always speaking the truth or attempting to, even though sometimes he might not have known all the truth. Mm-hmm. He always attempted to. And this is why he's in good condition in the spirit world as well, because he's in this state.
And the same can be said is sort of for Africa, with really the one who springs to mind is Nelson Mandela. There's many genocides and horrific things that have happened there, but the man who springs to mind first is the one who really led. He's walked an example
and you can see nowadays that many of the people who were following him in the past, don't like his lack of a hard line now. And then as a result, what happens? Everybody starts degrading in their condition. The nation starts degrading its condition as a result. And it's a natural result of, you know, these people inspire. And if you follow the inspiration constantly, then there is no danger of being misled down into a road of violence.
Yes.
But if you don't follow that inspiration, you will eventually go into a road of violence.
Yeah.
And this is why many religions have ended up in a road of violence.
Yes.
Because they don't listen to the leaders who initially inspired them.
Yeah.
And rather they follow their own concept of what is right and what is wrong. And eventually that concept is driven by fear, and so eventually it turns to violence.
Yeah. And if we go back to what Kushner said, I love the use of metaphor in these books, and he says, so it compels the preacher to drop the role of prophet and assume the position of priest or lawyer. There is no counsel of God to proclaim. He has only a written law to enforce. And he's saying again here, you know, the day of revelation, the day of prophecy is over. Now there's just the law to enforce. And because of that, there's no need for him to be in advance of his flock, leading like the Oriental shepherd. There are no new pastures into which the sheep can be led.
Exactly.
So there's this idea that we know all the truth that it's about. So this idea of the sleep state bringing us new truth and understanding is immediately going to be vetoed, because no, we know all the truth, and I'm not in a process of discovery myself, and my job is really to control what discovery you have, which is the opposite.
Which is discovery of the people before us, which we now tell people doesn't exist anymore. And I quite often like that analogy too. Like, a true leader shepherds his sheep by leading them and caring for them. A leader who doesn't care for his sheep fences them in.
Yeah, herds them from behind and fences them in.
Puts a fence around them so they can't go anywhere. Yeah. And that way he doesn't lose any, but none of them feel inspired, none of them enjoy their life.
They don't
move very far.
Yeah. The pasture is static.
Exactly. Yeah. And so it's very, very similar with the way people treat this, I feel. The role of the prophet is the inspirer the leader who leads into new places, places that have yet to be discovered.
Yeah.
Whereas, and I feel many scientists and many other people on the earth are like that. They are like the
shepherds
leading people into a new place. Yeah. And so I don't just feel that religious people or people who worship God do this. I feel that there are people who do this in every walk of life who Absolutely. Are the inspirers, the leaders, the people who desire to understand and know new things. And they are the ones who break the ground, if you like, yes. for the rest of humanity. Yeah. Much of humanity is used to following,
yeah.
but also they're used to being controlled, so they don't ever stretch out of their current comfort zone.
Yeah.
And a person who is inspirational does that.
And we talked earlier, we were discussing the Paget messages, and we talked about this idea of the great experiment and how many of us are afraid to experiment, and yet the true leader is in a constant state of experimentation.
Exactly.
He's a
perennial student.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, he's constantly the student of new things.
Yeah. And this, I appreciated something that you said in the way of the heart channelings, which was, I'll probably forget it now, but it was something, the true master is one who has mastered being a student, always. Mm. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's very, very true. Like, A person who's mastered being a student will continually and infinitely grow.
Yeah.
A person who's becomes a person who believes themselves to be a master, they are not going to grow very far beyond that point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I always feel honoured that at times I'm referred to or as your greatest student in the first century, and that's really how I felt.
Yeah, we're both pretty good students.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, let's get through this chapter because we, as I said, we can talk, us two.
We're almost there.
Yeah, we're nearly there. Okay, so Krishnan is now talking about the fact that prophecy used to occur in the sleep state a lot. It was accepted that people would have visions, or they would have someone come to them in a dream and give them truth or give them a direction. And there's references to this in the Bible.
Yeah, maybe if I can mention a few. Mm-hmm. I know he mentions a few just in passing, but if I can mention a few in a bit more detail, perhaps. If somebody reads the book of Daniel, for example, in the Bible, it's an Old Testament book, they will find that Nebuchadnezzar, the king, and also some other kings of the day, had dreams. And very similar to the same kind of dreams that the Pharaoh in Egypt had at the time of Joseph.
Mm-hmm.
And it was interesting that, like, if you look at those particular dreams, not only were Nebuchadnezzar, the king of the the Babylonian world power, not only was he having these particular dreams, but he had nobody to explain them to him.
Mm-hmm.
And then somebody came along, Daniel, who also had dreams in explanation to his dreams.
Yeah.
And these were all just sleep state experiences, explaining different things, piquing a person's interest, and then explaining to them about the future. And in fact, many of these dreams came to pass. They were foretold future events through this sleep state. And then the king of the Medo-Persia, Cyrus, also had dreams. And there were also other kings of Medo-Persia who had dreams. And Darius, I think, was one of them. And these particular people who dreamed often needed somebody to answer what their dreams meant, because they woke up with the feeling that it meant something.
Yes, they knew
they'd been given a message.
Yeah.
And this is just a form of prophecy in regard to this, a way of passing information from our sleep state to our awake state.
Yeah.
And it happened, and there are so many records of it happening in the Bible, and I find it ironic that even though there are so many records of it happening in the Bible, people are petrified of their sleep state and petrified of inspiration and petrified of any spirit interaction.
Yeah.
You know, there's also records in the Bible of me discussing things with spirits. I discussed things with two spirits at the time of the Transfiguration, you know, one of the most momentous times in human history was there. There were only five or six people present, and we discussed, spirits and people on earth discussed the event.
Yeah.
And then I discussed with dark spirits many truths and helped many dark spirits progress in the spirit world. And there's records of that happening in the Bible. And yet, there is this terrible blanket control, if you like, and fear-based control placed upon a person who's Christian, mm-hmm. that they should not and cannot, and, you know, they're going to be speaking to the devil if they do speak with a spirit.
Yeah.
And yet, there's so much inspiration that can come from those particular locations.
Yeah, and that's really what Krishna wants to say, you know, mm. that he often is drawing us to the lack of logic in yep. what was accepted in the past in Christian faith and now what is accepted. And
yeah.
And I...
Well, my own father would never have fled Bethlehem, as Krishna points out, without having some kind of spirit interaction and inspiration.
Yes.
Where he was led in a dream through a sleep state experience to no longer feel safe in Bethlehem and want to leave to go to Egypt. Yeah. If he hadn't have done that, I would have been murdered along with 20 or 30 other children.
Yeah.
But my father listened to the experience and felt impelled enough to act upon it.
Yeah, mm. yeah, absolutely, yeah. Okay. Then Fred asks an interesting question at the end of this chapter, and it's sort of a question that Igor alluded to before we started. But surely you would not counsel men to put faith in the So surely we shouldn't just put faith in every notion in every dream, you know.
Yep.
And one of the questions Igor had before we started was, how do we tell the difference between a dream and a sleep state experience?
Mm-hmm.
Did you find vagaries?
Yep. Yeah, vagaries of every dream.
Vagaries, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Because he's basically saying, look, some dreams are pretty vague, right?
Yeah.
you could basically interpret 25 different things from them, yep. if you wanted to.
Yep. Does that mean I should buy red shoes or red capsicums? Or,
yeah. Exactly.
And also, you know, sometimes we are having dreams and sometimes we're having
actual experiences.
Yeah. And
we need to tell the difference.
Yeah. Mm. Sometimes our fears are played out in dreams.
Of course.
And
they're not actual experiences.
Experiences. So how do we tell the difference? And yeah. how do we take notice of what we really need to take notice of?
Yeah.
So Kushner says that, like every other gift of God, this requires most careful development and education before it can become totally reliable in its operation.
Yes.
And we've already hinted, haven't we, in our discussion about the power of humility mm-hmm. in mm-hmm. our willingness to understand and take messages. And also, the more in touch with our soul we are, the more we're able to discern in our awake and our sleep states, aren't we?
Of course, it's a matter of developing trust, isn't it? So for example, if somebody tells us 25 things that are right, then there's a chance that the 26th thing that they tell us might be right too.
Yeah. Yeah.
If they tell us in such a manner that's driven by love, and we can feel the love, then there's much a higher chance again that the next thing will be
yeah.
true.
Yeah.
If they tell us 25 things that are right, but we feel a feeling of anger, rage, or other negative emotions from the person who's telling us, then there's a chance that we're being manipulated and controlled through the telling of truth.
Yeah.
If they're telling us the truth to make us feel good about ourselves, to feed an addiction, then there's a pretty high likelihood that there's something wrong and amiss with the person who's telling us the truth.
Yeah.
And that applies to whether they're on the earth or in the spirit world. So the key is going to be the fruitage of the person. If in the end the prophecy turns out to be true, as he points out,
yes.
then of course, it was a true prophet. But by the way, people who want to influence us negatively can certainly be true prophets.
Yeah.
You know, it's like a person coming to tell you the truth about something just to hurt you, even though it is the truth. You can feel, if you are sensitive, and this is what he's talking about and referring to when he says, like every other gift of God, this requires the most careful development
yeah.
and education.
Yeah.
What he's talking about is the gift of God that we have to be able to sense the feelings of other people. This is a beautiful gift of God, and it actually helps us determine greatly a person's intentions. if we can truly feel a person's other, the feelings coming from the other person, we will understand why they are saying a particular thing to us. And if we understand why, then we know what we can trust.
Yeah.
If they're saying something to us out of rage, anger, even though it's true, then we know it's not fully trustworthy, mm-hmm. because the spirit in which it's delivered is untrustworthy.
Yeah.
The spirit in which it's delivered has errors in it. If, though, it's driven, given in love and consideration and kindness and respect for our free will, and it's still delivered to us, and it turns out to be true, then it's highly reliable and something that we can work with in our future.
Yeah. Mm. And it is interesting, I think, you know, Kushner does say, if the prophet said basically this paragraph underneath, and he says, you know, if the thing follow not, it doesn't, and it doesn't come to pass,
mm.
then okay, they weren't a reliable prophet.
Mm.
But then he does say, by their fruits you shall know them.
Yeah, which is a quote from what I've said in the first century many times.
Yep. So again, if they prophesy accurately, okay, you know that they can do that.
But if they prophesy accurately enraged,
yes.
then of course there's a fruitage of rage coming from
exactly.
this person. So, you know, you have to be careful with that. If they prophesy accurately, but in an endeavour to control, and you can feel the level of control, then of course you've got to have some consideration of that.
Yeah, mm. Well, because his next sentence is, confidence in a prophet would always be regulated by the value of previous utterances, rather,
mm-hmm.
while the standard of trial would always be the cross of Christ. What does he mean by this, the standard of trial being the cross of Christ?
Well, he extends it, if you look further down, yeah. in context, and he's talking about the gospel of love. So if you examine the reason why I died, the reason why I died was because people around me rejected truth, mm-hmm. and rejected love. So you could say the cross of Christ, or the way in which I died,
yeah.
was the result of people's rejection of truth and love. So if we place the reciprocal of that upon every test that we make, truth and love becomes the test of every test that we make, then you could say that's testing it by the cross of Christ,
yes,
if you like,
yeah.
which is what he actually means. So go on.
No, that's just what I just... I wanted to show that Krishna is actually what you stated there about the fruitage of the emotion and the level of love and truth,
yep.
inherent in the prophet is also...
Yep.
is actually in what Krishna has said to Fred.
Exactly. Yeah. So yeah. it's not just the gospel of love, but it's the gospel of love and truth.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, I feel that this is something that has been missed out by many, that, you know, many have forgotten that it is the truth that sets you free. It doesn't bind you.
Mm-hmm.
And the reality is, for many religious customs, it's binding rather than freeing. And this was an indication of it, that it's false. But if it was tested by, you know, on the points of the reason why I died, if you look at, for example, my conversations with Pilate just before my death, it was a conversation about truth, not just about love. And the reason why I died was about love. Like, that was about, you know, how much I loved my friends. But it was also in a sense that how I loved them enough to not have them pay for my... For the anger that was directed at me. In other words, I wasn't prepared to flee the country and then have my friends die on my behalf. I felt I wanted to take responsibility for what I taught, and therefore took responsibility and was in a state of love about taking responsibility for my teachings, even if that meant my own death. But also, I was still talking about truth at the time of my death, or near the time of my death. And it's this amalgamation of truth and love that really is the reason why I died, is the lack of love and the lack of truth that caused my death.
Yeah.
Nothing else, no sacrifice, no other thing but the lack of love and truth that caused my death. Now, if every utterance from so-called prophets was just tested by those two conditions,
yeah.
love and truth, not one or the other, but love and truth together, then it would be very easy in most cases to determine the truth about what's being said by spirits or by people in the dream state or who have had a dream or what, any of those things.
Mm-hmm.
You can very rapidly tell what's true and what isn't. If On the other hand, you're only telling truth without any love, or there's so-called love, but there's no truth whatsoever. People are lying to you, and I don't call that love at all. Then, of course, that is proof to me that the source of the information is flawed and therefore not something worth remembering or following. Yeah. And certainly not something worth listening to for a long period of time,
yeah.
unless you wanted to talk to the person and have some logical discussion about their inaccurate way of seeing things.
Sure.
So that is really what he's referring to there. And if you think of our lives in the first century, a lot of it went to teach these things. A lot of it was about teaching these particular things, that the sleep state experience, the awake state experience, that there is no death, that you don't need to be afraid of death and so forth. And, you know, these are all the things that we taught then,
yeah.
and still haven't really reached the earth now.
Yeah. and you know, at the end of this chapter, Fred says to Kushner, what a boundless gospel you open to the vision. Like, just the teaching that Kushner has just given him in this one short chapter is amazing. And, mm-hmm. and then Kushner says this very beautiful thing, that I would love to read. He says, this is the gospel, and it is not such an one as we might and is it not such a one that as we might expect from a God of love? It is the gospel lost in Eden, faintly seen but dimly comprehended by patriarch and prophet of old. Its daybreak glories were sung by the angels in peace on earth, goodwill to all men. For a moment it shone with noonday glory around the life of Christ. Then the shadows of systematic theology began to obscure it. And the twilight has deepened into night, and in the darkness of which men could scarcely recognize the Nazarene if they met him.
Hmm. Which is proof in my existence on earth right at this moment, and people can scarcely recognize me. Even the billions of Christians can scarcely recognize me now that they meet me.
Yeah. And I just feel it's so beautiful the way that Kushner is a poet after my heart. You know, he says that this gospel, the gospel of the God of love, was there in Eden. In the beginning, it was there and it was strong. But then it was only faintly seen and comprehended by all the prophets and all the leaders and, you know, spiritual leaders that came after that.
Mm-hmm.
And then for a moment it was beautifully clear and lived and transparent in your life.
Mm-hmm.
And then we've just descended into these shadows far away from this beautiful gospel of love and truth. Mm. And
so much so that people could not even recognize me nor the gospel itself.
Yeah.
When it's delivered again.
And I was telling you during the week this
Can I read the rest of it?
Sure.
He says, I only tear away the clouds, 1,000 sects and creeds. And by the way, there's about 33,000 Christian sects and creeds at this point. I only tear away the clouds, 1,000 sects and creeds have conjured up to obscure the sun. And free from prejudice, invite you to see what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, free of any of the limitations devised by man.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah. And it's just so incredible, this gift of love that God has bestowed. And I feel that you are still living this example, and I know at times you feel like you wish you were at one with God again so that it would, you know, be even clearer and stronger through you. But my reflection during the week was that it was how little even the people who we know day to day actually observe you, because I observe you a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And the gospel of truth and love is lived. And because of all this damage that Kushner is talking about and we hear about in this book, that Christian faith has has obscured the view of who you, your true character and nature. And people have this idea of their Jesus and what Jesus was really like and how Jesus should be and what it's going to be like when he comes back, and I would know, and it's going to be,
as we have emails
all the time
showing us every day.
Yeah, and I'm not judging those people at all. I just am in a different point of perspective, and I see something very different because I don't come to you with, although I did, I don't now come to you with this huge idea of who you should be. And by actually interacting with you, I learn a lot about God and truth and love. And
yeah, and I think, you know, this is one of the things it'd be good to discuss in some frequently asked questions that we do about, you know, there's a lot of Christian belief systems based around the Bible, and we're constantly being told that we can't be Jesus or Mary Magdalene because of the Bible said this or the Bible said that, with people not understanding at all how the Bible has come about, and and how, as Kushner says here, how systematic theology began to obscure the light. And I did foretell it would occur, and there are scriptures in the Bible that show that I foretold that such a systematic destruction of truth would occur. But it's interesting that many of the people who are now involved in the results of the systematic destruction of true Christianity now believe they have true Christianity, and I'm the false person. The person who founded their faith is false. And that's something that I feel over time, again, through by my fruits, people will eventually recognise the truth again. But I feel there's many people in the spirit world, of course, who already know the truth, and therefore much inspiration that can come through our sleep state to help us understand the truth about whether what I'm saying is true or not. So again, that people have this opportunity to use the sleep state and to use their dream state as a way of testing the truth, as a way of finding out and testing the truth. And this is very, very powerful.
That was some of the homework that I was going to suggest for people following along, was that because the next chapter we continue to deal with the sleep state, and so as you read the next chapter over the next week or month or however long you take to do it, take the opportunity to grow your desire to know what's happening in your sleep state. Everyone wants the magic bullet as to how do I remember? And the way you remember is by growing this desire, and growing the desire to be humble to whatever it is you discover. So,
And also to probably ask themselves the question, like, if I cannot remember my sleep state and my experiences in my sleep state, you know, what particular things am I terrified of knowing about myself?
Yeah.
Because that'll give a good indication generally about, you know, why they can't remember
things. And that's such a useful question that I employ very often when I'm faced with a situation where I'm stuck, or I feel like the next course of action is just unbearable for me. I just ask, well, what is the thing I'm most afraid of? Because it's very illuminating, and it usually helps me get unstuck. You know, if you can face your worst fear, even if intellectually, sometimes it does do a lot. So
That's been a good discussion.
It's been
today,
great,
darling.
Thank you very much.
And I hope everyone and the listeners have enjoyed
it.
The
not minded too much our long and sometimes diversionary discussions, but I think we were in context a fair bit. So we'll see you next time for chapter 15.
Cheers, everyone.